Live NFL trivia every Tuesday night on Twitch at 9 p.m. Eastern. Come show off your football knowledge and have a chance to win cash prizes. Check the link in the description to find out more. And now, on with our feature presentation. When a player leaves a team, for the most part, there is nothing surprising about it. What I mean by that is even if the decision to cut the player itself may raise some eyebrows, the actual procedure involved in it is not. It's a pretty structured process. The team announces that a player is getting cut, and then the player gets put on waivers or enters free agency. There's no mystery about it. That's the way it works, and that's the way it has worked for a long time. But sometimes, you get absolutely bizarre situations. And in 1987, the Philadelphia Eagles and Ron Jaworski were involved in one of the strangest ones you'll ever see. Jaworski held a press conference thanking the Eagles for everything, and now he was going to enter free agency. The only problem? He wasn't a free agent, and the Eagles had him under contract. No one knew whether or not he was actually a free agent, and it was a bizarre situation with a pretty bizarre ending considering the circumstances. And this is the story of the controversy during the 1987 offseason involving the Eagles and one of the greatest quarterbacks in their franchise's history. Before I talk about the incident, we need some context as to the player in question, because it will help us to understand why this was such a big deal to begin with. The main focus of this story is none other than Ron Jaworski. In 1977, the Philadelphia Eagles acquired him from the Los Angeles Rams. Head coach Dick Vermeil knew that his team needed a quarterback. Roman Gabriel was going to be 37 years old in 1977, and was clearly not the same man he once was. And Mike Borella was terrible. I made a video about Borella somehow making the Pro Bowl the year before in 1975, so you can learn more about how that bizarre situation happened by clicking the card in the upper right corner. Jaworski wanted out of Los Angeles after he lost his starting job to Pat Hayden and Shaq Harris following a poor start to the 1976 season, where he threw just one touchdown and five interceptions. The Eagles were hoping that by acquiring Jaws, that he would live up to his potential and become the quarterback that Philly was desperately looking for ever since that Sonny Jurgensen trade over a decade before. And sure enough, they got their wish, as Jaworski had a really impressive stint with the Eagles, and I think that goes without saying. In his first year, Jaworski started every game under center and finished 7th in passing yards and 3rd in passing touchdowns across the entire league. By 1978, he led Philly to a 9-7 record, which was not only their first winning record since 1967, but their first playoff appearance since 1960. But perhaps the most notable year of his career was in 1980. During that 1980 campaign, Philly went 12-4, winning the NFC East and getting home field advantage in the postseason. Jaworski made the first and only Pro Bowl of his career after throwing for a career-high 27 touchdowns and 3,529 yards. He won the Burt Bell Award, given to the top player in the NFL that year. And of course, he guided Philly to their first Super Bowl appearance in franchise history, as the Eagles ended the season with an appearance at Super Bowl 15. Though Jaworski would continue to be a solid quarterback throughout the first half of the 1980s, that 1980 season was easily the peak of his career. Jaworski would not win another playoff game in Philadelphia after that season, nor would he make another Pro Bowl, nor would he have another winning record after 1981. He was entering his mid-30s and was starting to decline. And in 1986, it seemed like the writing was on the wall and his time in Philly was gonna be up. In 1986, the Eagles got a new head coach. The Marion Campbell experiment had mercifully come to an end, and in 1986, the Eagles acquired the hottest name on the market, acquiring legendary Chicago Bears defensive coordinator Buddy Ryan. Even though the Eagles drafted Randall Cunningham in the second round of the 1985 NFL Draft, they still really liked Jaworski, and liked him enough to give him a four-year contract worth $2 million, or an average of $500,000 a year. That's a lot of money, especially since the average salary in 1986 was only $198,000. And especially since, according to an Eagles spokesperson, Jaworski was entering the season as a backup. But they still wanted a veteran like him on the team. Cunningham didn't exactly inspire a lot of confidence in 1985, throwing one touchdown and 8 interceptions in his time on the field. And Jaworski, even though he was not the same quarterback he was in his prime during the turn of the decade, was still a pretty consistent option, all things considered. The good news for Jaws was that he was able to win the starting job. And even though he wasn't great by any means, and even though the Eagles were struggling to win games, he was still looking alright. Through the first 9 weeks of the season, he had thrown 8 touchdowns and 5 interceptions, and had one of the best games of his career when in Week 4 against the Rams, he threw for 213 yards, 3 touchdowns and no picks, in a 34-20 victory. The bad news for him was that on November 9th, in a Week 10 game against the Giants, he was about to play his last snap as an Eagle. On the first drive of the second half, Jaworski tore a tendon in the little finger of his passing hand. What's bizarre about this injury is that this was the last snap he took. There was no contact or anything like that, nor was there any contact on the drive. However, immediately after the game, the Eagles ruled him out for the rest of the season. Randall Cunningham took over under center, and looked considerably better than he did the year before. Over his final four starts, he threw 5 touchdowns and 1 pick, while scoring 3 rushing touchdowns and posting a passer rating of 87.3. Now, obviously, that's a 4-game sample size we're talking about here, but if you extrapolate that over a full season, he finishes with the 6th highest passer rating in the league. In other words, he was ready to take over and be the Eagles' quarterback going forward. That, combined with Jaworski being 36 years old by the time the 1987 season started, combined with Jaworski being on the decline, and combined with the fact that he suffered multiple injuries during the season, with the other one being numb fingers that forced him to miss a game against the Cowboys, it was time for both sides to move on. The writing was absolutely on the wall. And with that, Jaworski pens a goodbye to Philadelphia and announced it to the world. The only problem? He was never cut. He was still under contract. That raises the obvious question. Why did Ron Jaworski declare free agency the same way that Michael Scott declared bankruptcy? Was this his way of showing that he was unhappy and trying to force his way out? Not exactly. You see, as part of the contract that Jaws signed in 1986, which was that 4-year deal, Jaworski was due $600,000 in guaranteed money by March 1st. In Jaworski's eyes, if he didn't get that money, then he was going to be a free agent. It makes sense, and we see situations like this all the time, where a team refuses to pay a player before a March deadline, that player gets released, and then that player hits free agency. The Eagles were obviously not going to give him $600,000. That's a lot of money back then, especially for a guy who was going to ride the bench and was on the decline. Plus, the Eagles already had their veteran backup quarterback, as Mack Cavanaugh was acquired from the San Francisco 49ers for a 3rd-round pick and a 2nd-round pick. Why the Eagles traded away that much draft capital, I don't know. But it wouldn't be the first time they traded a ton of picks away for a quarterback who did nothing. You can learn more about that incident by clicking the card in the upper right corner. So with the Eagles not giving him the money, Jaworski held a press conference at a New Jersey restaurant and held back tears as he announced that he was no longer going to be an Eagle. After saying his goodbyes, Jaworski announced, "Somebody is going to get another quarterback for a real bargain right now, because they're not going to have to give up another player." In other words, Jaworski was a free agent, and it was open season. The only problem? The Eagles said not so fast. In Philly's eyes, just because they didn't pay the $600,000 that he was due didn't invalidate the contract entirely. In Philly's eyes, Jaworski was still on the team and he was not a free agent. General Manager Harry Gamble put it bluntly, saying Ron is not a free agent. He must advise us that he wants to be placed on waivers. Gamble continued, saying that the team wants Jaworski there, doesn't want to let him go, and they want him to come to training camp and work something out. Head coach Buddy Ryan added on to that. He said that he wanted to have 3 quarterbacks on the roster, that he liked the 3 they had in Cunningham, Cavanaugh, and Jaworski, and that he wanted to make roster decisions in August instead of March. With that, we had an absolutely bizarre situation on our hands. Ron Jaworski believed that he was a free agent. He thought he was gone, and that by not receiving the money owed to him, he was free to sign anywhere. The Eagles thought that he was still under contract, and they had no intention of letting him go. That raises the final question we have to ask ourselves. What the heck happened next? And how did this bizarre saga come to an end? Before I explain how this ended, I should note that this is not exactly the first strange controversy involving Ron Jaworski and his contract situation. Remember the trade I mentioned from a decade earlier about how the Eagles acquired him from the Rams? Apparently that trade was illegal. He wasn't under contract with the Rams at the time of the trade. However, nobody in the league caught it in time, and nobody raised any objections, so because of that, the trade was allowed to stand. And just like Jaworski's arrival into Philly was a bit of a mess, so was his departure out of the city of brotherly love. The bad news for Jaworski was that the Eagles were right. Jaworski was not a free agent, and he was still under contract with the Eagles. The good news for Jaworski, though, was that this saga was about to come to a rather drama-free end, because 2 days later, the Eagles released Jaworski and sent him into free agency. After a decade with the Eagles, his time in Philly was over. And because Jaworski cleared waivers, and no team wanted to take on that contract, he could sign wherever he wanted. He signed with the Dolphins in August after Dan Marino suffered a dislocated finger in the preseason, served as the backup in 1987 and 1988, then finished his 15-year career in Kansas City in 1989. Now, the odds that we see another situation like this, especially in today's NFL, are slim to none. There aren't any secrets with how contracts work, and each team has a cap specialist and a team of guys to prevent situations like this, where a player genuinely doesn't know his contract status. Ron Jaworski is remembered very fondly by Eagles fans to this day, and rightfully so. When you're a good starter for a decade and lead the team to their first Super Bowl appearance in franchise history, you're going to have a pretty good legacy. but the way his playing career ended, to say the least, was nothing short of absolutely bizarre. Be sure to like this video, ring the notification bell, subscribe down below if you haven't already, as it helps the channel out a lot. And be sure to check out Twitch every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern for your chance to play NFL trivia and win cash prizes. Link in the description below. If you want to see videos like this condensed down to 60 seconds, then follow me on TikTok at JarroGator9 and subscribe to 60 Second NFL History on YouTube. To see highlight videos of players throughout the history of the NFL, subscribe to JG9 Highlights. Also, special thanks to all of our Patreon supporters helping the channel. Your support is greatly appreciated. See how you can become a patron and request future video topics in the description below.